predominantly because of the lower prices of crude, quarter-to-quarter basis, and the related product prices, which also led to the lower GRMs. Yeah. We had a significant inventory loss, particularly if we compare with Q2 of last year, and there was a delta of close to 4,000 crores, which probably is more than the difference what we are seeing in the profitability between the two quarters. The GRMs had been suppressed apart from the inventory loss, also because of the lower cracks, which is the difference between the mainly, if you talk about the two major products, gasoline and diesel, and the crude prices. Now, these are, while the crude prices are driven by demand supply as well as the geopolitical situations, the product cracks or the product prices are driven by the demand and supply, which had been fluctuating, not only because of Indian conditions, but predominantly because of global conditions and the demands in different parts of the world. So we had been seeing, the quarter one, the cracks were extremely poor. Quarter two, we saw a little improvement in the cracks, and which are now seem to be improving. So we expect the next quarter we should be having decent GRMs and better profitability.
Right, and how is the sale volumes panning out in the second half of the year now?
If we look at the growth numbers, if you look at the growth numbers for different products, we are seeing decent growth for LPG because having achieved close to 97% of penetration, even 4.5% of growth of LPG is fairly decent. Comparing with the earlier growth numbers of 9%, 10% or double-digit growth, which was predominantly driven by the new connection supplies. Today we have saturated as far as the market or the penetration is concerned to a very large extent, and today it's only depending upon the actual demand growth where we are getting these numbers. Gasoline or petrol, we are seeing very decent demand. We are still seeing close to 8% growth quarter to quarter basis, which is fairly decent in spite of all the slowdown which we are seeing in terms of sale of new vehicles. So I think when it comes to the personal preference for driving vehicles, we are still seeing gasoline consumption growing. Coming to diesel, diesel is predominantly driven by transport sectors and agriculture sector. If we take other fixed consumptions like railways as constant, quarter two typically remains a low demand month, mainly because of the monsoon and rainy months, and which fairly get impacted by heavy monsoons or delayed monsoons or floods in a couple of regions, which we saw particularly in this year. In spite of all this, during the first half of the year, we saw 1.1% of diesel growth, which normally, because the diesel volumes are very large, if we compare with the gasoline numbers, the diesel volumes are nearly 3.5 times of gasoline. So diesel base is very large. So even 1.1%, I won't say it's a very high demand, but even 3% diesel growth is considered a good demand. In earlier years, we have seen even negative demand of diesel. So from that point of view, I think in spite considering everything, considering the impact of heavy monsoons and everything, I think we are still seeing a decent demand of diesel.
Right. Now, government aims to open fuel retailing to non-oil companies. What does it mean for you? Does it mean kind of a threat?
Not at all. I won't say we are seeing it as a threat, but let me share. In a very short response, we are seeing opportunity to provide more value to the customers. I think it will bring in more efficiency in the system. It will bring in more competition to everything. Even today, the retail sector or petrol and diesel retailing is open for private players, open for multinationals, and they are already present in the country. The way we are doing pricing today, we are floating with the global prices. So we are already competing with the global players in terms of price. We are already competing with the global players in terms of the retail marketing and services. So when it opens up for even for the medium size or the small size players, I think they will bring in a little more efficiency at the retail level. And it will definitely open up more opportunity for the large players like Indian Oil. In this line of business, what is extremely important is to consistently reliably supply fuel 24/7, 365 days in a year, which requires not only the apparent or the face of the marketing or the face of the retailing, right, which requires a very robust and reliable supply chain and complete system behind the scene.
Mm-hmm. Now the freight rates, we saw that they're surging in the recent past, but you did mention they were normalized. Do you expect it to continue?
Let's see, difficult to say, because the way the freight rates, I mean, you're talking about the shipping rates, which flew up in a very short time,
right,
because of some sanction of one particular company or a few companies of a country. So we saw immediate increase in the freight rates, which impacted us definitely, because the freight immediately goes up. But very quickly it again normalized also. Now let's see, because the freight is something which is which definitely is driven by many factors, and not only by demand supply alone.
Mm-hmm.
But today I can only say that today we are seeing again coming back these freight rates, the shipping rates, to a reasonable level once again.
Right. And how do you see the movement of crude oil in the second half of the FY20?
Difficult to say. I think nobody can predict the crude prices, but let's analyze. If we analyze a couple of major incidents which we witnessed during the last couple of months, of course the Saudi incident was a typical case which showed the robustness in the whole system. If we talk about the global system, I think in spite of a large supplier getting impacted, or a big chunk of supply going out of the whole system, still the whole system could still balance itself, which shows the robustness of the whole supply demand scenario, which is a very, very positive sign in such a situation. And we should also see this happened when the Venezuela was already under sanction, when a couple of other oil producing countries were not producing at the full capacity, when the OPEC and OPEC Plus were still restricting themselves, individual countries were restricting themselves as per the mutual agreement for production. So I think considering everything else, it was a wonderful demonstration of the strength of the whole system. Now we look at from an Indian point of view. Even when a large supplier of India got impacted, in spite of that, the total supply chain for the country still remain alive, and we could see no shortage of any kind as far as the petroleum products or the crude supply to the country was concerned. So I think overall, the global players as well as the Indian players manage the situation very well.
Mm. Now, if you look at the global refining margins, they continue to be weak. How do you see that impacting players like BPCL and other OMCs?
I think because you see, whenever the situation of inventory losses are happening, Indian Oil is impacted most because we carry the maximum inventory. We have the most inland refineries, so all our stock which is inside the pipelines or on the ships undergoes the impact of inventory loss. And the same thing happens when the situation is for inventory gain. Unfortunately, it happens when the prices are going up. So while I'm sure that other oil companies will also get impacted, but probably the impact will be less.
Mm. And out of refining and marketing, which segments reported weak numbers and rationale about that?
You see, when we are talking about, because the refineries carry much more inventory, so when it is impacted by refinery margins or low cracks or inventory losses, the refinery division is impacted more.
Okay, and can you give me some updates on the BS6 upgradations? Where are we at?
We are absolutely on track, and we are absolutely confident that from 1st April 2020, we'll be able to supply. Mm-hmm. In fact, a couple of refineries like Digboi, Barauni, they have 100% moved to BS6. These refineries and some other refineries have, because some refineries are producing today BS6 diesel, some are producing BS6 gasoline. So these refineries have started supplying BS6 to the market, but what is still reaching to the petrol pump nozzle is still not BS6, because the whole system needs to be flushed,
uh-huh,
which is the process has already started.
And last two questions, sir. Any plant shutdowns for the second half?
I mean, the refineries, as I said earlier, a couple of refineries have undergone shutdown and they have upgraded themselves. Final hookups are still going on. So these are all plant shutdowns, and which we have factored in to meet the requirement of ES6.
And what are the pending subsidies from the government? I think as of July, and it was close to about 9,772 crore.
I can only say that nothing extraordinary, because we had been receiving the subsidies from the government on a very regular basis, and we don't foresee that anything will remain outstanding.